Well, happiness. Go ahead and show my first slide there. Happiness. I was reading an article, and the article said this. It was in Parent Magazine, and it said this on the article. It said, people who decorate for Christmas earlier are happier, according to psychologists. And then underneath it, it said, haul out the holly. Psychologists claim that the earlier you put up Christmas decorations, the happier a person you are likely to be. So Real Life Church, we are happy, all right? We got the Christmas decorations out. Why? Because we're happy, right? The reality was we looked at the schedule and said, we do not have time to do this later. Let's do it now before it really gets busy. So, but man, I love Christmas decorations. The article, when I was reading the article, it said, I was going to try to set because I'll just be honest with you, I'm a little tired, I'm still tired and weak because of being sick this week, but I can't set down, it's hard. But I was reading it and it said this, I love this, it said, people get happier when they walk in and they see Christmas decorations. When you see the lights and there's Christmas songs you hear, when you hear Bing Crosby begin to sing, that's Christmas, right? For me, also, one of mine is Elvis. I like to hear Elvis sing. Thank you. I like to hear Elvis. I like a blue Christmas. I'm talking about happiness, but I like blue Christmas. See, what does it do? Those things bring back memories of a happy time. I mean, come on, let's face it. Christmas, for most of us, Christmases are happy times. As kids, you wake up and you get the presents and you have all these things. Christmas is a happy time. So as soon as Christmas comes around, that happens that way. And then even people who did not have a good childhood for Christmas, they overcompensate by over-decorating and doing this because now they want the happiest time. So Christmas, the lights, all that brings happiness. You know what I love about it is Christmas, which is Christ's Mass, and we celebrate the birth, that should bring happiness. It should bring happiness. So we're going to talk today, because last week we talked about different things, that some things that can bring up unhappiness in us. And one of the things I mentioned to you was people. People, right? People can make you unhappy. People can drag you down. People can begin to come to bother you a little bit, right? Well, just this weekend, Christy and I, we had to go Saturday, was it? We went to Sam's, and we're at Sam's, and of course the place is just crowded. It's already started, and it's so crowded. And we're walking through, and you got your cart, and you got all these people, and it's one of those days where you go to get a cart, and there's like one little stack of five carts. That's all that's left. Okay, that gives you an idea how busy it is. And so we get one of those carts, and we're holding on to that cart because the other day at Sam's, Christy had stuff in it, and we went to go look at something and came back, and our cart was gone. We're like, did they just take our stuff? And it was just gone. So we had to go find stuff again, and it was just crazy. And then that's when you say, people, right? We're walking through Sam's, and while we're pushing, Christy's in front of me, and she's pushing the cart, and this one lady's coming through, and the lady in front of her, she's coming the opposite way. The lady in front of her is not moving fast enough, so she goes around her, hits our cart while she's trying to get through and push, and God bless you. You know, what are you? And then we're driving. It's, you know, the holiday traffic's there. I mean, we already have bad enough traffic as it is, but now holiday traffic's coming in, and whew, I had to remember, or she had to remind me, I have an RLC magnet on the back of my car. So I had to slow down. People. So today, what I want to talk to you about is happiness. But how do we have happiness in relationships? The people that we come in contact with. Because, would y'all agree, people are one of the biggest problems with our happiness. So, four relational habits that I want to share with you today, and all of them come from Philippians, the book of Philippians, chapter 1. Philippians 1, Paul gives us four things here that are habits for us to be able to live by. And here's the first one. The first one I'm going to give you is be grateful for the people in my life. Be grateful for the people in my life. Philippians 1:3 says, every time, this is what Paul says, every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. I want y'all to think about that for a minute. Can you say that? That person that's driving you nuts, that person that's just like, you know what, if I have another phone call from them, when you're praying for them and you're grateful for them, and I just thank Jesus for you. Let's think about this for a minute. Do we really act that way? Do we really pray for them? It's been documented, again, by psychologists that over and over again, that those people who are grateful, people that show gratitude, are happier people. The more ungrateful you are, the more unhappy you are. You talk to one of your kids and they're just going on about, well, this is this, and I didn't get to do this, and I didn't get... Yeah, but you got to do all this. And you got to start pointing out again, there's reasons for you to be happy. Then they're like, oh yeah, you're right. They wanted to kind of bask in that ungratefulness for a moment, and we don't let them. And that ruins it for them. How many of everybody just comes in and ruins your moment of pity? And you were happy in your pity, not really happy, but you were really doing good with your pity. And someone comes in and brings some sunlight into it, and you're like, oh man, you just ruined my pity time. You know? Being grateful. Be grateful for the people in my life. Paul, at this time, is in Rome. And he's writing to the church in Philippi. Paul is showing us right here to thank on the good times. In a marriage, if all I do is focus on the things, I know y'all think she's absolutely perfect. But if I just focus on the things that irritate me, because there's plenty of things I do that irritate her. If we only focus on those things, we're going to become very unhappy with each other, because everybody has those things. And if we focus on those, what's going to happen in a husband and wife? You start focusing on the little things. Satan loves for you to focus on things that are just going to bring you down. And when we focus on those things and focus on those things, we're going to start to make choices that are going to take us down a road that's miserable. So, be grateful. I want you to answer this honestly, okay? When you think about the people in your life, is your first thought gratitude for them? When you think about the people in your life, is the first thought gratitude? No. Matter of fact, statistics say that 90-something percent. When your first thoughts are how I can fix them, how I can do this, how they need to change, if they did this way, they'd be much better. That's how we think about people. Anybody with me? So, if all we do is focus on the negatives of people around us, you're not going to have any friends, are you? If all you do is focus on the negatives of a person, you're never going to want to hang out with them. And you're going to be unhappy. We are not by nature grateful people. Matter of fact, by nature, we are selfish people. It's only Christ that changes us. It's Christ that changes us. This is why you have to work on habits that can bring you happiness. Because those things don't just come easily. They're not natural. Because the flesh is weak. Amen? So, he says, every time I think about you. You know what I like about that is that's present tense. That's not saying, you know, when I used to think about you. He's saying, every time I think about you. When I think about you, I give thanks to my God for you. Every time I think about you. Look at this story a little bit more here in Paul with Philippi. Philippians is written, it's an epistle, it's a letter to the church in Philippi. The church in Philippi was started at the house of a businesswoman, her name was Lydia. How many of you guys remember in Acts chapter 16, they stop to wash their feet in a little creek, and there's a woman there. They begin to talk to her, they baptize her, and they go back, and she says, come back to my house in Philippi. Lydia was a businesswoman, she was a seller of purple goods, remember that? Anybody remember that part of the story? She was a seller of purple goods. Purple was a very expensive fabric in those days. They would have to go and they would get the ink out of shells deep in the ocean. And they would bring those in and they would get the ink out of it and they would dye things this purple color. I think I'm impressed with Lydia because in a man's world at that time, by far, was a man's world. Lydia was a businesswoman who was successful. She was against the odds. So Lydia said, come back to my church, and the church started in her home. Now, what's interesting to me is Paul says, whenever I pray, why are you on number two? Go back to number one, please. Wow. Every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. Every time I think of you, he says that. Here's the thing that's interesting to me, because when he meets her and they go back to her house and he meets some more people and some other people say, we're going to follow you, Paul starts going out into the streets of Philippi. He starts preaching. And you know what happens to him next? These people that he thinks so fondly of, these people that he says, whenever I think of you, I give thanks to God. Paul is taken by those people and he is stripped naked, tied to a pole and beaten. Then he's put in prison, and then an earthquake comes while he is singing at midnight, the midnight hour. He is singing praises to God while blood is dripping from his back, and the earthquake happens, shakes the place. He comes walking out of it. He ends up leading the guard to the Lord, goes home with him, leads his family to the Lord, baptizes all of them, and then the city officials tell Paul, get out of our city and don't ever come back. But Paul says, every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. I give thanks to my God. Sometimes our problem when it comes to people is the memories that we have of them, we focus on the negative memories. I mean, come on, if you're sitting in a room and let's just give you a really good setting. It's raining outside. You're by yourself. It's cloudy. It's a yucky day. You're already feeling kind of gloomy. And then you're just thinking about someone, and all you think about is how this person does this, this person did this to me. And then you start to build a narrative in your mind of what that person is probably saying about you and doing about you and what they might do next. And you're getting really mad at this person. They ain't done nothing, really. But you're getting mad at this person because the enemy loves to take you and just work on your mind. And while you're doing all of this, then you come to church. And that person says to you, what's up? What's up? You know what's up. You, buddy, you're talking about me. I know you're doing that. And you all of a sudden get mad at that person because we're living in a state of something that happened a long time ago. Paul, beaten, thrown in prison, told to never come back, says, whenever I think of you,
Every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. So the problem is, here's one thing. Here's something that just, if you can hold this, remember this. Memories are a choice. Memories are a choice. What do you choose to remember? Memories are a choice. There's a story of just illustration of two ladies, and they're talking, and one lady says to the other, "Do you remember when your husband did such and such?" And the other lady replies back, "I distinctly remember forgetting that." Memories are a choice. If you want to hold on to your painful memories, go ahead. But you are going to be miserable. You're going to be miserable. So, I'm giving you each one of these points, and you have them in your notes, happiness truth bombs. Just happiness, little happiness truth bombs for you. So go ahead and hit it one more time. You'll see it. Happiness truth bomb number one, remember the best and forget the rest. Remember the best and forget the rest. How many of y'all think that's some good advice? Remember the best, forget the rest. Number two, your second point. Number two, pray with joy for the people in my life. I want to pray for joy. Paul teaches us that. Philippians 1, 4, verse 4. Go to the next slide if you would. That next slide tells us, Philippians 1, 4, Paul says, "Whenever I pray, I make my request for all of you with joy." Well, he's making a request with joy because he chooses not to remember the bad things. He's praying for you with joy in his heart. Joy in your heart helps you to pray with faith. Joy in your heart, you pray with a positivity of that person. And I'm going to show you in a moment, boom, 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 boom. How do you pray that? I'm going to show you something today that I'm praying that when you write it down, you take it and you begin to put it into habit. So, Paul, whenever I pray, I make my request for all of you with joy. All right, for a moment, think of someone who irritates you. Don't look at them. Think of someone who irritates you for a moment. When you think of that, do you pray for that person? Or is that a person that you nag because you want them to change? Is that a person, instead of praying for them, do you nag, do you nitpick? Or you feel anger with them at times? Let me ask you, has nagging or hating worked? Yes or no? No. It has not worked. But does prayer work? So why not pray for them? Pray for them. When you pray, do you pray with joy? We always want to change people. There's things about my kids I want to change. It was easy when they were little. When they were little, you just told them what to do and they did it. And they were happy with everything you did. Now they're teenagers. It all changes, doesn't it? Am I right, Mom? Yeah. They got this mind of their own, it's fun. I love the talks we have with our girls. I love it. I love sitting and seeing their minds opening up to things when you sit down and talk with them. But there are times. People that you, when you pray, we always want to change people. We want to change our family members. We want to change our neighbors. We want to change whoever. If he would do this, if she would stop doing that, we want to change the people around us. The thing is, if they were all like me, everything would be perfect. We laugh, but we know we think that because the change that we want them to make is to be more like us. You can't change. You can't change anybody. You can't change anybody. You can change yourself, but you can't change anybody. All the thinking, the negative thinking, none of this, nothing but prayer will change things. Positive prayer. Positive praying is more effective than positive thinking. Positive thinking is a big thing. Got all kinds of books about positive thinking, right? We got guys making millions of dollars holding conferences about becoming more of a positive thinker and you'll make more money, right? Positive thinking. There's nothing wrong with positive thinking. The problem is positive thinking only changes you, but positive prayer can change the world. So, I agree with positive thinking, but it's got to translate into positive prayer. Because positive prayer is what changes things. Happiness truth bomb, next one. Where's my next? Happiness truth bomb. The quickest way to change a bad relationship to good, start praying for them. This person, I don't know why, but I just have a... Get Ronnie, I want to see this person. I can't believe they said this about me or did this. And a lot of times you'll find out that what you think is usually blown up and it's not really true. But if you begin to pray for him, how much will that change, that relationship? How do I pray for him? How? In what way? Paul shows us example, Philippians 1, 9 through 11. Go to the next slide. In Philippians 1, 9 through 11, Paul does this. He says right here, and this is how I know this, because he says, and this is my prayer. This is what Paul prays for people. Paul was beaten. We already talked about Philippi, but we have other situations where Paul was ran out of cities. Paul was drug away. Paul was, man, he was stoned. How do you pray? Because each one of those places, there were churches that he planted. And he's praying for those people to come to know Christ. So how do you pray? How do you pray for people that just tick you off? How do you do it? How do you pray for others without getting too personal with it? Lord, I just pray that God, you just... Lord, let them know that plaids and stripes just don't go together. Don't let them wear that anymore, Lord. I just pray. That's not any kind of prayer. But we pray. Sometimes when we pray, we're griping to God. And we're telling God how to fix people. So how do we pray for them? How do we pray for them? I love this because Paul says it. He says, and this is my prayer. This is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and the praise of God. So what does that prayer do? There's four things there. Look at them. Number one, pray they'll grow in love. Pastor Brad stole my lunch money the other day. But Lord, I'm just going to pray. I'm not going to think about that. Lord, I just pray that he will grow in your love. Do you know what that covers? Do you know what can come from that prayer instead of your specific prayer about your nitpicky prayer? Showing your guns, you're going to take me down? Pray. He says it right there, and this is my prayer. He says that your love may abound more and more. That they will grow in love. That I will grow in love. That's a prayer for you to pray over yourself. It's a prayer for you to pray over your friends, your spouse, your family. It's the prayer that I was praying when I came down here this morning. And a specific person came to my mind. I started just praying that prayer. Lord, help them to grow. Help them to grow. that they will grow more in your love, more in you. Not in the world, but in you. I pray they grow. God will speak to you when you pray prayers that He has given to you in His book. When you're praying a prayer like this, you're agreeing with Him. Because though this is there, I want you to know, Paul might have wrote it, but he was the co-author. The Holy Spirit was the author. So, next one that will make wise choices. We'll make wise choices. He says there in the scripture, he says in verse 10, able to discern what is best. Able to discern what is best. Pray, help them to make wise choices. Help me to make. Please, church, pray this prayer over me. Pray it over me. We'll make wise choices. The next one that we'll live with integrity. Oh, Lord, I pray they'll live with integrity. What is that? Same thing, verse 10, right after where it says, able to discern what is best, it says, and maybe pure and blameless. To be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, that they will live with integrity. Do you know how much is being covered by these simple words? The fourth one, that they will become like Jesus. Lord, make me more like you. God, I pray. I pray for my children. I pray for my daughters to be more like you. They'll be more like you. Pray it over your kids. They'll be more like you, Jesus. Where does that come from? Look at verse 11. Filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ. If you're filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes from Jesus Christ, what are you? You're going to be more like Jesus. To be more like Jesus. Paul, I love it. This is my prayer. How many of y'all have ever even noticed that before? That Paul says, this is my prayer. This is how I pray for people. This is my prayer. So, we're going to pray. Please, that's what I told you. I stopped this morning and just did a handout for you because I want you to have notes today. I want you to have notes today. I see a bunch of y'all taking pictures of the screen today. I want you to have notes because this is important. This will change. We pray too many times when we pray what we think. And I got news for you. We don't see tomorrow, but He does. So why not just pray lined up with Him? Paul lays it out for us. So we pray, grow in love, make wise choices, live with integrity, and become like Jesus. You begin to pray that over someone that you're having problems with, I promise love is going to intervene. Our next point, Paul gives us is expect the best from people in my life. Begin to expect the best from people in my life. Expect the best. You can go to that next slide. Expect the best. You know it's true. We expect the worst in people. We see people that start to do it and just like, oh, I know where this is going to go. I've seen this. That's what we remember and we base it on our, right? Paul is saying, make a habit of believing in people instead of criticizing them. That's hard. That's hard when there's a history of disappointments. The scripture brings me, this scripture I'm going to show you, it's not my scripture for Paul, but just I want to show you a scripture. This is a scripture that brings me no joy. But this is a scripture that the way we think. So the next scripture. 2 Peter 2:21-22, he says, it would be better
If they had never known the way to righteousness, then to know it and then reject the command, they were given to live a holy life. They prove the truth of the proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and another says, a washed pig returns to the mud. Man, when I read that, it would be better. People who come in and they start to follow Christ, they start to, and then some of us go, oh, I've seen them do this before. I know where they're going to end up. Well, that's not helping them at all. Paul said, expect their life to change. Expect God to get hold. Expect for things to happen. But it's so easy to fall into this. And it's the truth. It is. That's the world. But we are not part of this world. So it says here, and this right here is this is about backsliding. Some people say, well, that's not possible. I just saw not too long ago on Facebook a teacher I had at my Baptist Christian school put up a whole thing about how crazy people are if they think you can backslide. I don't think I'm crazy. I'm just reading the scripture. It says it'd be better. And then that last one says, a washed pig returns to the mud. What is that? You've been washed with the blood of Jesus Christ, but you return back to the sin that he had cleansed you from. Does that make anybody else see that, or am I just putting things into it? That's terrifying to me. I hate that scripture because that scripture is true in the world. I love the Word of God, but sometimes the truth hits and hurts. When I read that, it bothers me. I don't ever want to be a cause of this. I don't ever want to be a cause for someone to do this. The nagging, the putting down, the griping instead of the praying. Do you know there are people today that are away from Christ that won't step foot into a church, not because of Jesus, but because of people? They won't step foot in a church. I have friends, kids that I grew up with that will not go to church today because of people, how they treated them. Jesus wouldn't treat you that way. He wouldn't do it. I think it was Gandhi. Gandhi made one statement one time. He said, your Jesus, I'm okay with. It's just the ones that follow him are the ones I have problems with. I think he said that Jesus, but it's the Christians. People. Paul, who wrote, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Paul, the writer, he tells us this. Paul was great at bringing out the best in people. So listen to what he says here. Philippians 1:6. Go to the next slide. Philippians 1:6 says here, and I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. That sounds like someone who believes in a person. And it's not that he just believes in that individual, but he believes in what the power of God can do in an individual. He believes. Paul gave confidence. Three things that we learn from this little scripture right here. Three things quickly. And you can just write these down. I don't think I have a place for them in your notes. He believed in people. Paul believed in people. He says here at the beginning, I am certain that God, the NIV says it, I am confident, it says. He believed. Do you believe, or are you like, well, I'll help him. I don't think it's going to work, but I'll. Am I right? I'll try. Paul said, I am certain that God, he believes in what God can do. So number one, he believed in people. He was certain. He was confident. He was certainly confident in the work that God can do. And by that, he gave them confidence. He gave them confidence. The girls just finished their second season of volleyball. And we love going to our girls' games. We love cheering for them. And they played on two different teams this year. One was the middle school, one was the high school. And man, we just loved yelling for them. It's so funny because Christy actually sweats more than the girls during the game because she's all at the edge of her seat. And she's like, she actually has sweat pits under her arms. She is so worked up. And we're yelling for them and we're cheering for them. I remember the very first game they ever played last year. First game. It's Claire's first ever game in a sport. Ella played softball 1 year when she was little. And about three games into the season, she said, "Do I have to finish this? I thought this was dodgeball. I didn't know that this was softball." And we said, "Yeah, you're going to finish what you started." But remember, Claire was, she didn't start. It's the first time she ever played the game. And they put her in a little bit later, and I went, "Yeah, now you're in trouble. Claire Frost is in the game." All the parents went, "Now you're in trouble, Dad." But we cheer for them, and you know, when they make a mistake or they're not there, something happens, because it happens easy. You're out there in front of a bunch of people and you make a mistake and you hear some people going, "Oh." You're like, "That's okay, that's okay. You got it. You got it. Come on." You know? I'm cheering for them. That's what you do as a parent. That's what God does for you. That's what your Heavenly Father does for you. He's cheering for you. You just made a mistake. He's not going, "Well, you," like some parents, I've seen this, "I can't, you're such an embarrassment," and they walk out of the gym. What is that saying to that kid? Your Heavenly Father has never said, "You're such an embarrassment." When you make a mistake, he's going, "Come on, come on, you got this. I'm with you. I'm right here with you. You got this." And he's cheering you on. He's building confidence. Paul, what we see here is Paul is saying, "I am certain that God," he's showing confidence. He's showing confidence. The good parent is like the good father, encouraging you. The second thing we see from this is he gave people vision. The Bible says, "Without vision, my people perish." He gives them vision. He says, "Who began the good work within you will continue his work until it is finally finished." That's vision. Paul says the work started in you is going to continue. That hope and that vision. It has been proven that when people have expectations put in front of them, they will do better. Number three, he was patient with people's progress. He was patient with people's progress. If you insist on perfection in people, you are going to be miserable. Nobody is perfect, only Jesus. Right now on the world stage, we have a situation going on where we got a number of people, a number of Christian leaders who are just waiting and watching for this individual to fall. Show the video that I have for today, just if you guys could.
So this is legitimate?
I believe so, yeah. I believe so.
If not, we praying that it is. Yeah.
God can use anything for his good, you know? So if this is the atmosphere where, you know, some people need to be reached, then God will use it.
I mean, the music is beautiful. It's awesome. Very moving watching this, you know, but everyone is always so suspect of Kanye and his motives, and he's Hollywood and he wants to sell records. What was your takeaway from being there?
I was one of 17,100 people in the forum, and it was let me try to describe it like this, Martha. It was one part hip-hop concert, maybe one part just Kanye being Kanye, doing a lot of fun, crazy stuff. Maybe two parts a gospel choir and a really good one, as we just saw.
Amazing.
And maybe three parts a Billy Graham crusade style revival.
Yeah.
But it's Kanye West doing it. So it was fascinating.
Do you think God could be working through Kanye West?
Of course. He's very good at working through very flawed people, including me and you and Kanye West. I was fascinated.
I'm definitely flawed.
Yep.
I mean, I think it's very interesting. And, we'll see if it sustains in him. And, I hope that it does for him and for his life. I think it's interesting he's focusing on taking back Sundays. And one of the things I read about what he's doing is it's very Bible-based. It's very traditional Bible-based. It's not like he's making up a new faith. He's been training in a very traditional Bible-based faith. But he wrote this song that he's, getting some snickers called Closed on Sunday. And it has the Chick-fil-A line in it. Listen to this.
Closed on Sunday. You my Chick-fil-A, hold the selfies, put the gram away, get your family, y'all hold hands and pray. Raise our sons, train them in the faith, through temptations, make sure they're wide awake. Follow Jesus, listen and obey.
That's a pretty powerful message.
Yeah.
He likes Chick-fil-A. He's got to be a good guy, right? Do you know how many people are just waiting for him to fall? Is it real? Is it this? I don't know. He's at the Forum. That's where Magic and Kareem played. He rents it out right now every Sunday, and he's packing it out. And people are giving their heart to the Lord. I just pray, Lord, help him to grow in your love. Lord, I pray, help him to make wise choices. Help him to live with integrity and help him to become like you. But see, a lot of people just want to point out what he's done in the past. And he's done some crazy things, ain't no doubt. Some real sin there. I saw a thing flash up the other day and it said, it showed someone, they were praying and saying, God, give us another Paul, someone with that moment where they turn and their change, their turn to you will wake up other people. And the next picture says, which says God's voice coming out, says, I gave you Kanye. I don't know. All I'm going to do is pray for him. I'm not going to judge him because that's not my place. I'm going to pray for him. If you look, it's amazing because he always in the past had this kind of anger about him. If you watch him, there's a video on YouTube where he is, what's the guy that does the karaoke drives? The late night guy, Jim Corden. And instead of in a van, he's in an airplane with Kanye. And the entire crowd in the plane is his choir. And he asks him questions, and his choir sings. The entire time, Kanye is smiling. Remember, we're talking about joy and happiness, right? He's smiling. I've never seen him smile like that. I haven't seen a lot of Kanye, but I've seen pictures of him. And he's usually ticked off. But he's smiling through the entire video. And it's interesting to watch. This week, while after he did his service last Sunday, during the week, he was in a prison. It's on YouTube. You can see it. Then he's in there. And there's even a part where he's leading people through the sinner's prayer. And you've got prisoners and you have guards on their knees praying the sinner's prayer. Yeah. Okay. Something bad could happen out of this. I'm going to pray he'll continue to grow in you. What you started in him is going to finish. Amen? Let's don't judge. Because every one of us are going to fall at times. If he falls, I'm going to pray, God, just pick him back up. picking back up. Happiness truth bomb for this, Lord. Celebrate how far people have come rather than judging how far they still have to go. Celebrate how far they have come instead of judging how far they still have to go. Let me do my last point. We'll move through this. The last one is, Paul shows us, love the people in my life like Jesus does. I always pray that, God, let me see people through your eyes. Let me see people the way you see them. It's easy for me to tell you this today. It's easy for me to say, love people like Jesus does. Do it. Get the bracelet. It's easy to say it. It's a lot harder to do it. So, Paul says this in Philippians. He says in verse 8, God is my witness that I tell the truth when I say that my deep feeling for you all comes from the heart of Christ Jesus himself. He loves you because if he loves you from his own self, his own heart, he's going to remember the bad things you did. He's going to remember the hurts. He's going to remember the pains. But he says, love like Jesus does. I tell you, my deep feeling for you comes from the heart of Christ Jesus himself who lives in me. Paul, former pastor of the church, Philippi, he started it. He's still supported by them. Matter of fact, when he's in prison, there's a guy that brings it to his, Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus, they send Epaphroditus while he's in prison in Rome. They send Epaphroditus with a gift for him. Now, he's not carrying a new lamp or something. If it's a gift, it's a monetary gift. Just what we do for missionaries today. And it says that Epaphroditus takes the gift to him, and while he's there, gets deathly sick. Read about it. It's in the book of Philippians. He gets deathly sick. Paul prays for him. He spends longer time with Paul, then comes back, and many believe when he comes back, he's carrying the epistle to Philippi that we're reading. Paul, who his church still supports him, he deeply loves his church family, a pastor. As a pastor, not a day goes by, I don't think of you guys. There's things about you that I think about you. I drive, if I see Carowinds, I don't think of rides. I think of Jason's auto shop, is where he sells cars. Because that's out by Carowinds. That's my thing. And when I think about it, I pray for his business. I pray for him. When I go to a pharmacy, I think, pharmacist. I think of Paige. I pray for her. There's things that when we get to know each other, there's things about each other that thing makes us think about that person. And I pray for you. I think about you. But do we think about people the way Jesus does? It helps us when we pray for people that we think about them as Jesus does. 1 John 3:16. Listen to this scripture because it gives us a great thing about how do we're supposed to love people like Jesus did. Look at 1 John. Go to the next slide. 1 John 3:16. There should have been a slide in between there. 1 John 3:16. I'll just read it to you. It says, this is how we know that love, what love is. This is how we know what love is. Christ gave his life for us. We too then ought to give our lives for others. Let me say it again. This is how we know what love is. Christ gave his life for us. We too then ought to give our lives for others. Does that scripture kind of sound familiar? Christ? There it is. No, it's not. All right. All right. I don't know where it went. Philippians 1. Oh, my truth bomb. Okay, yeah, that's it. That's my truth bomb. This is how we know what love is. Does that sound kind of familiar? Christ gave his life for us. Kind of something else? Really familiar. 1 John 3:16, maybe John 3:16. Maybe John 3:16. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever, that's any of us. Whosoever, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We love that scripture because it's about us being free, having everlasting life. It's about Jesus sacrificing for us, and we're okay with him sacrificing for us. We love that scripture. We ignore 1 John 3:16. Because 1 John 3:16 is about us doing something. Because he died for us. That is how we know what love is. And then we too ought to give our lives for others. That means you might have to be inconvenienced sometimes to be Christ for someone who needs Christ. To be in that moment. To love them. This is real love, and we must do the same thing. We must do the same thing. There's a lot of stuff here. A lot of stuff here in one chapter that Paul gives us. And so, I've got one last part, and this part you don't have to write down. It's there, and that's the next slide. You were already there before. You found that one. And I just messed you up on the other, so sorry. Closing and evaluation. Which of these 4 points do you need to work on? I want you to go home, and I want you to look over this, and I want you to pray over this and say, God, where do I need to? What do I need to do? Which of these 4 points do you need to work on? And who, because of their faults or flaws, have you not been grateful for? Because of their faults or flaws that you weren't grateful for, how many of you have someone in your life to say, God, show me who that is? Because I got work to do. Next, are you praying for the people in your life? And are you praying for them? Or are you complaining when you talk to God about them? Gave you 4 great things how to pray for people. Make a prayer list of people to pray for and pray what Paul prayed over people. Who do you need to start loving from the heart and not the head? Because my head will not let me love them like Jesus did. But my heart will.